Thank you, Dr. Ritul, for those good words. Thank you so much. Thank you, Bansi sir, Agarwal sir, and the RSSGI team for this invitation. My topic is avoiding hypoglycemia during travel. So basically, I will try not to cover what the other previous speakers have already spoken about. So I will just restrict my talk to this hypoglycemia during travel. So causes of hypoglycemia we have already discussed, but what is the problem with these causes during travel? First is incorrect insulin administration. So many times in moving vehicle, patients try to take that insulin or take it, and the dose is really maybe less, maybe more, and that will cause hypoglycemia. So it's better to stop the vehicle and take the insulin in such situations. So anyway, we'll talk about that later on. There is insufficient exogenous carbohydrate intake during travel, so there may be decreased endogenous glucose production. We see so commonly people consuming alcohol, and this may cause decreased endogenous glucose production. Increased utilization of carbohydrates. So there is anyway, usually there is very very much increased physical activity during the travel, and that may cause increased utilization of carbohydrates. Increased insulin sensitivity may be there because of that exercise, as well as the nighttime travel, nighttime activity also. There is delayed gastric emptying. Sometimes patients are just sitting, and that may cause delayed gastric emptying. And there is decreased insulin clearance. So all these may be related to the travel causes of hypoglycemia. Signs and symptoms are already covered. So what can be the problem with these signs and symptoms? They may be mistaken as a sign of jet lag. Sometimes patients may have nausea, vomiting, and that may be motion sickness. That may be these symptoms may be attributed to that motion sickness also. And many other things, patients are confused because of lack of sleep also, that may be confused. So all these confusing symptoms and signs may overlap the signs of hypoglycemia, and detection of hypoglycemia may be difficult in such situations. What are the risk factor in these traveling people? First is cognitive impairment. We know very well patients who are elderly, they have cognitive impairment, and in these patients hypoglycemia detection, especially during travel, may be really difficult. There may be nausea, vomiting because of motion sickness. Sometimes we see there is excessive physical activity, as I discussed. There may be wrong dosages, wrong technique. There may be mismatch. Sometimes patient takes insulin and walks little bit to go to that terminal or go to the gate or go to the bus and may not eat something, and maybe may land up in hypoglycemia because of that. And alcohol intake, which is a very common cause of hypoglycemia, that is what we have seen. What hypoglycemia can contribute to during travel? First is dizziness and weakness, which again can be contributed to jet lag or just tiredness because of the travel. But there can be hypoglycemia, and this may be again mistaken as some other problem. Falls are very dangerous during the travel. If the patient is at some height and if there is a fall, there may be serious injuries. Injuries even on the ground also may be really serious in these patients. And very importantly, motor vehicle accidents. Diabetics, hypoglycemia is one of the cause of motor vehicle accidents. So patient education, what we have to do, it's just the introduction was that part, and now what we have to do for patient education to prevent hypoglycemia. The first is very important: office visit with the healthcare professional at least 4 to 6 weeks prior. Here one must tell the healthcare professional what is the duration of flight, what is the duration of travel, what is the time difference between these during these flights, or maybe place of embarkation and disembarkation, what is the time difference between these two. Diabetic meals are sometimes having very low glucose or low carbohydrate. They itself may cause sometimes hypoglycemia, so diabetic meals may not be really always advisable in all the patients. Regarding patient education and planning ahead, this is a very poorly covered part in clinical practice. I went through so many papers for reading this, and I found out that there are no clear-cut guidelines. Most of the papers mention that only just 10 to 15% patients went to the doctors prior to their travel, and only 25% patient counseled or gave some constructive advice to the patient. So almost 75% times it is not covered from our side also. That we have to really think about and improve that part. Obviously, there are no clear-cut guidelines by any society for the travel of prevention of hypoglycemia during travel, or even overall advice during travel. That may be one of the reasons, but anyway, this is a very individual thing, I feel, when we advise it to the patient, because what is to be done is very particular for that patient, and we have to do it that way. So we have to think first that we are going to do this in each and every patient for prevention of hypoglycemia during travel. So recommendations to avoid hypoglycemia, I will just say more of. Physician letter is very important. Though at most of the airports, they do not give any importance to the physician letter because that can be forged according to them. So see, this is a serious and written in the paper also. But nowadays, it's just useful to detect which molecule the patient is on if the patient is not able to carry the medications or the insulin. In case of sulfonylurea-induced hypoglycemia, we may need to observe the patient for a longer time. In case of short-acting, we may not need, which is just 4 to 6 hours is okay. So this physician letter may be important for that. Identification and medical alert bracelet, as Snehal has already told, that they are important to know others that the patient is having diabetes and may land up in hypo. Health insurance is very, very important, because many times hypoglycemia is covered on OPD basis, because the glucose is low, give dextrose and let the patient go. That can be the approach, and that may not be covered in the insurance. So wherever the patient is traveling, they have to make it sure that it is being covered, or what are the procedures to get it covered, that has to be taken care of. And rescue medications, glucose gel and all the tablets, we have already discussed, but they should be easily accessible. We see so many times patient is sitting in the chair or in the seat, but the medicine is just in the bag or somewhere, and patient is not able to take it out or not able to tell the next person that I'm having hypoglycemia and just get me that. So rescue diabetes medications should be nearby, extremely nearby, so that the patient can take and consume it. 2 glucose meters, so it may not be possible in every cases, or the batteries should be with there at least, but 2 good glucose meters are very essential. Complex carbohydrate sources are important, because there might be sustained hypoglycemia, and the complex carbohydrate sources may prevent the further hypoglycemia even after correction of the initial part of hypoglycemia. So this, before starting, we have to check the supplies, basically that all the carry-on luggage is easily accessible, as I said just now. On board or during travel, for those who are on oral agents, truly speaking, there are not at all a good paper which will really tell me about this. So this I am telling whatever the expert opinions are there, or whatever I would do. So metformin can be continued, pioglitazone can be continued. Sulfonylurea, if possible, if the patient is on longer acting sulfonylurea, we can go to epaglenide or some shorter acting sulfonylurea. If not possible, make the dose half. But that is again little bit dicey, because I would really not, if the patient has had a previous episode of hypoglycemia, I would really stop sulfonylurea, especially longer acting sulfonylurea, for a day or so. Because hyperglycemia, most of the papers see that you can skip a dose and keep the patient slightly hyperglycemic for a few hours till the patient reaches the destination. That may be really useful. Coming to SGLT, there are no papers at all, SGLT2 inhibitors. But what I feel, we can continue, because it may not cause hypoglycemia. Only thing is, whenever there is nausea, vomiting, that time SGLT2 inhibitors may cause some euglycemic ketosis, and there we have to be really careful. So if we think some patient is having borderline creatinine or and some IHD, heart disease, some or cerebrovascular disease, I will not advise even SGLT2 inhibitor. I would just advise metformin, or any sitagliptin, any gliptin would do for that matter. But the bottom line is always that you can skip a dose if you are not sure, and let the patient be hyperglycemic for a few hours. During travel, what happens? So adjusting insulin injection and meal time while crossing time zones is very important. But in any case, frequent blood glucose monitoring every 4 to 6 hours is very, very important. Even though patient is not monitoring himself or herself at home, not even in once a month, but such patients should monitor themselves every 4 to 6 hours. A normal, whenever we are doing changes, we have to consider a normal 24-hour medication schedule, and then change accordingly. So traveling from north to south, usually over 24 hours, the changes are not required. But traveling to east or west, we have to change a lot. So time zone, if it is between less than 3 to 5 hours, more than 3 hours we have to make some or the other change, more than 5 hours we have to certainly make a change. So eastward travel, usually whenever we are traveling eastwards, there is shortening of the day and the reduction of insulin would be required. So most of the guidelines are saying that a reduction by 10 to 30% of insulin would be really useful. Given the morning dose, let the patient go there, given the morning dose by reduced by 10 to 30%, or if it is long acting, make it 2/3, or and short acting boluses you can give according to the whatever patient is eating, that can be done. And let the patient, need not, you may not give the night dose because you will be reaching early to that place, and start with the regular dosages next day morning. So that is the most preferred approach, I would say. So if these are the, again this is by the education program, by Canadian education program, I found it little okay, so I am posting it over here, I am referring it over here. So for OD insulin, you can give 2/3 of the usual dose on the day destination is reached. For twice daily insulin, inject 2/3 of the insulin in the morning dose, and usual dinner dose is the same, and from usual doses is from the second day onwards, as I said. Basal prandial, I would say little, give again little less, 2/3 or 10 to 30% less of basal dose, and give prandial boluses according to whatever the meal patient is going to take. In elderly patient, even prandial boluses, I would say we should give little less. Not really, if the patient is really young and can take proper meal, can understand hypoglycemia, yes, we can go for whatever bolus dose is advised. But in elderly patient, I would say instead of 8 units, you can go for 6 units or 4 units. Even if the patient remains little hyperglycemic, that is okay. In one study, this is a journal of modern pharmacy, but reference I was not very sure, but I just thought this is very easy, that is why I am referring it. They found that increasing the dose by 2 to 4% per hour of time shift for westward flights and decreasing by 2 to 4% of time shift for eastward flight was sufficient. For westward travel, usually there is a longer day. The day is going to be extended and we may need some additional doses of bolus insulin, not basal insulin. But again, there can be some problem because there might be different times of departure. So usually what happens from here, patient goes to Dubai or somewhere in the Gulf, and there from they take flight, next flight. So there can be long waiting period. So not really every time we need to really increase the insulin. We may go for the same dose, or we may sometimes reduce the dose also. The flights may be prolonged. So usually westward travel, usually increased insulin may be required, but not always. There is a complicated approach will be required in such patient. What happens to insulin pumps? So though I have very few patients, hardly any, I mean, and they are very intelligent that they do not come to me when they are going to travel. So this is the truth, I would say. Whenever there is ascent, there is a decrease in the ambient pressure. In the cabin also, there might be some decreased pressure. And in those situations, it was found that the insulin delivery by the pump was little more. Up to 1 unit increased delivery was seen with Medtronic pump. And during descent, there was sucking in of the insulin in the syringe. So sucking back, and there might be some hyperglycemia which may not be of consequence, but if there is hypoglycemia, the hyperglycemia may be after 1 or 2 hours, you can say. This hypoglycemia because of this may be after 1 or 2 hours, and that is why we need to be really vigilant. Even if the patient lands down, that time also there may be hypoglycemia. So in general, first day we would prefer that leave the wristwatches unadjusted during the flights so that they can take insulin accordingly, maybe in a little dose. And easier for the patients to judge, it will be easier for the patients to judge the timing of their insulin injection and the meals. And later on, from second day onwards, they can start according to the time wherever they are. What is the glucometer reliability? So the temperature best where the glucometer performs is between 15 to 35 degrees centigrade, and extreme temperatures and humidity can affect. But the overall effect was maybe underestimation by 1 to 2% each 1000 feet gain. There can be overestimation with some glucometers, but underestimation was found more commonly. If there is overestimation, then we are seriously maybe in problem. The glucose may be high and the patient may be in hypoglycemia. But anyways, we all know when to act, and we usually teach the patient when to act actually. So even if the blood glucose is of sometimes back we discussed about relative hypoglycemia. So if it is 120 and 130 and patient is having hypoglycemia, then we can obviously treat that patient considering as relative hypoglycemia also. Which blood glucose meter should be used? Usually the glucose dehydrogenase based blood glucose meters are shown to have better precision and accuracy as compared to glucose oxidase, because the oxygen, partial pressure of oxygen would go down with the high attitudes. In the hyperbaric conditions, all the glucometers were okay. That's what was stated by most of the papers. Only thing is like the glucose oxidase is and GDH, both the glucometers may be doing really okay in the flight, in the cabin, because the pressure is maintained in those cabins and we can use over there. So whenever someone is going for trekking, this may be really useful, the GDH based glucometers. Sensors. So the Enlight sensors connected to iPro, Guardian, Guardian Real Time, all the devices, they provided values continuously. In hypobaric conditions, the input signal for glucose was significantly different in both low and high glucose concentrations, and we have to be really cautious this time. In hypobaric conditions, what the CGMS or the Libre people say that you can one can use the sensor for up to 30 minutes up to a depth of 3 feet only and not more than that. That's what is told by the Abbott people to me. So maybe if one is planning for something, swimming for a longer time, then we have to maybe he has to come back and wait for some time and then go again. Some driving and diabetes, we have to really assess it individually. When I came across this driving and diabetes, what ADS is, diabetes care, said that there are high chances of this accidents by the 16 years old as compared to a diabetic lady who is 30 years old. She will cause less accidents as compared to the 16 year old. So maybe we should not deprive the patients with diabetes from driving. And medical history is very important in such cases. And we know those who are having retinopathy, nephropathy, neuropathy, we may not really advise, though our patients may not listen, but we usually do not advise that. And potential risk assessment, especially insulin treated patients and those who had previous exposure to severe hypo are more likely to have accidents. So in these patients we have to be really careful. So recommendations while driving: check blood glucose no more than 1 hour before the start and preferably every 2 hours if the patient is on insulin or sulfonylurea. Blood glucose should be above 90. Check after each physical activity and altered meal routine. Do not start driving, especially this is very important because brain may take 30 to 45 minutes to recover, and one should not start driving even after the blood glucose is normal for at least 30 minutes. And throughout the trip, we know that the meals can be delayed and available, physical activity will be increased. There might be some underwater or beach activities. Swimming is very important. If the patient is into hypo, there are chances of drowning. So blood glucose every half an hour is very important. Care of pump and sensor is also important. Even if the pump goes off, the patient may go into hyperglycemia, so we need not worry. But for hypoglycemia, yes, we have to check it. One more important thing which I felt was important, U100 and U40. India has most of the patients are on U40, and they usually abroad there is U100 is mainly used, and using U40 syringe for U100 may cause hypoglycemia. U100 vial will cause hypoglycemia, and this has to be kept in mind while the patient travels. So treatment we have already discussed. So my take home message will be, we have to plan in advance, patient as well as we have to be really careful what we have to tell it to the patient. Personal identification insurance are important. Frequent monitoring in high risk patients. Changes in insulin regimen may be required, and staying a little hyperglycemic is seriously okay. Easy access to simple and complex carbohydrates is necessary, and whenever there is hyperglycemia, obviously we have to treat aggressively. Thank you very much. Thank you.